APISIX was a hard zero-day web hacking challenge from the real-world CTF. The description reads, Apache APISIX lets you build cloud-native microservices API gateways, delivering the ultimate performance, open-source, scalable platform, and free remote code execution bugs for all your APIs and microservices. We are given an API and port to connect to, as well as some challenge files. In the end, 14 teams solved it, and our team SourCloud got the first blood. When you connect to the challenge IP and port, you have to solve a proof of work. In this case, brute force a hash that starts with 26 bits of zero. That's kind of like Bitcoin proof of work. They do this because they want to start individual instances per player, and solving a computationally expensive proof of work serves as an anti-DOS measure. Someone from our team, SourCloud, implemented a brute force program in Rust, which was fast enough, but that's not the actual challenge anyway. And we don't really need to connect to the real service because we were given files for a local setup anyway. So let's look at the files. We have a test flag, a Docker Compose file, and a config. As you probably know from my videos, looking into the Docker Compose file is a good start because it describes all the services. So we have etcd, which is a key value store like a database, and Apache APISIX, the name of the challenge. As you can see, we have no custom code, just plain up-to-date latest version of APISIX with this config. Does that mean this challenge is basically about finding a zero day in APISIX? Let's find out. First, we can have a look into the config. Now, it might seem interesting that there is an admin key, but this is actually the default key. If you look into the APISIX repository, you can find that key everywhere. I mean, they write here, using fixed API token has a security risk. Please update it when you deploy to production environment. But there's a good chance that people still use that key. Anyway, let's keep that in mind. As you can already tell, this is not a typical CTF challenge. Like the GitLab challenge from a previous real-world CTF, we have here a real-world, large, complex application with lots of code and features. It's the latest image from Docker Hub. So this challenge is closer to a normal pen test than a CTF challenge. It's almost like you work with a client and you are supposed to do a security audit of the project. Another great example how good CTFs are not unrealistic. Anyway, how do we approach this now? If you remember the GitLab challenge, you know that back then, just before the CTF, there was actually a security update. And you could find the security fixes, including tests, in the commits and thus figure out the vulnerability and exploit it. So immediately we were wondering if the vulnerability was also reported and if we could find commits fixing some kind of vulnerability. We looked at the version of the latest image on Docker Hub and then tried to figure out which GitHub tag that is, and then we used GitHub's compare feature to look for recent code changes. Of course, there are just tons and tons of changes, but we could maybe search for admin and see any admin related changes or maybe authentication related. Of course, we also looked at the change log, and Lucas even found an issue that seems security related, but didn't look that interesting after all. We also worried that maybe in the latest image it's not even vulnerable anymore because there was a new one pushed just 10 hours before. So maybe it was fixed? I contacted a CTF admin and they confirmed the latest image is still vulnerable. Alright, we have to change strategies. In parallel, we also started studying the APISIX documentation. What the heck is even APISIX? Turns out it's a fancy microservice gateway thing, kind of like a proxy. You can define routes, so URL routes, and configure an upstream server to forward the request to. For example, with this admin API request, you can create a new route that lives for only 60 seconds. It will configure the server to have an API route AA index.html and forward it to some other service listening on localhost 1980. And that's basically what APISIX can do. Configure some routes and have different features like the expiration or how to load balance incoming requests. That's it. And as you can see, with the admin API key, you can configure routes. And reading the documentation, you can even see that there is an option for scripts, and scripts are cool. In theory, you can write arbitrary Lua code in script. So it's clear. If we could talk to the admin API, we could easily create a route with a Lua script that reads the flag. But the problem is, you cannot reach the APISIX admin route from the outside. Here, I'm using my cool burl alias for curl. So we basically use curl, but we send the request through the burp proxy. Anyway, I try to get the configured routes from the admin, but we get a forbidden error. But if you go into the container with Docker exec and from the inside execute curl to the admin API, it works. So the admin interface is only accessible from localhost and not from the outside. And that's why probably many people don't change the API key. The admin API is accessible from only localhost anyway. My immediate reaction was, maybe we can find the SSRF. A server-side request forgery where APISIX itself triggers a request. And then the source of the request should be localhost and we can talk to the API. But of course, no clue if there is even such an issue. So we started exploring the very limited attack surface. As you can tell, we have the default config and no routes configured. We cannot exploit a badly configured route. This is just plain APISIX. So what is even exposed? We started looking into how APISIX is implemented. At the core of it all, we found Nginx. Here I'm in the APISIX container and basically the only processes are Nginx. The Nginx config would be interesting as this is probably the entry point into anything from APISIX. Let's find the config in the container to have a look at it. Here, for example, is the admin API route configured to only allow localhost and deny the rest. So immediately, this kind of sucks because I doubt there is a bug in Nginx server configs that allows to bypass a restriction like this. But maybe other configured routes and features override a setting or allows us to do the SSRF attack. Or maybe there are generally other Nginx misconfigurations. So I started reading through this and Googled a lot, but couldn't really find anything. gRPC though was something that caught my attention. Maybe if you try to access the admin API through gRPC or HTTP2, maybe that works. I don't understand much about gRPC, so to be honest, I guess it only works if you have SSL, and this is not the case here, not sure. All I know is that all my dumb attempts didn't work. Anyway, looking more through the config, we learned that APISIX is basically implemented in Lua. In the Nginx config, you can find various access by Lua blocks. This is where they call into their APISIX code. And so looking at the general default route accessible from the outside, APISIX HTTP access phase is basically the main code we deal with. And several people from SourCloud started to review the Lua code. Maybe there are bugs in there. In parallel, some others were just dirbusting the exposed API. Even though no route is exposed, we saw that there are various default plugins. And so maybe plugins have registered their own routes, and because it was a bit intransparent what kind of routes were registered by the default plugins, they just brute forced it with a word list. While they did that, I went down the Lua code review path. I basically modified the code and added debug prints to explore how an incoming request is handled, how the URL path is handled, especially in terms of URL decoding and path normalization. Could, for example, a basic path traversal bypass somehow the API route check? But yeah, nothing really worked. But suddenly, everything went super fast. Flow discovered an exposed plugin called batch requests, and that plugin will perform requests for you. It's basically SSRF as a service. You can configure here a list of requests and all of them will be executed, and you get the results of it. Is that the solution? Immediately, we tried to reach the admin endpoint, but it didn't work. Forbidden. And in the Nginx server logs, I saw the request client source was 172, not localhost. So from somewhere, it still took my actual client IP. Damn. Managama was looking into the batch plugin Lua code and saw that it actually set the X-Rail IP header to the current client IP. So that's the reason why it didn't work. I then just thought, what if we set the header ourselves? Maybe we can override it? But I also remembered the header smuggling article I recently read about on my Twitch stream and decided to add some variants with spaces and different cases. Sent the request and it worked. But only for me? In our Discord calls, others were reporting it didn't work for them. But there, clearly, it worked. Turns out I just got lucky. As you can see, I sent the request multiple times. A lot of times it says forbidden, but sometimes it just works. I didn't investigate, but I guess the header order was random, and sometimes it took my fake header and sometimes it took the real header. And that was it. That is the vulnerability we needed. Now we can easily access the admin API and push a malicious route. Flow quickly wrote a Lua script we can use for a new route that reads the flag. Let's craft here the request. The admin API is routes push, and the body has to be a string. Content type is already set, so let's try it. If we get forbidden, we just have to try again. There we go, it should have worked. Let's use the admin API to check if we successfully added a new route, and we did. So now theoretically, we should be able to access almayo1234 to read the flag, and it worked. Awesome. Let's head over to the actual challenge server, solving the proof of work and getting the IP and port. Now simply adjust the request target URL to the challenge server and issue the request. Again, if we get forbidden, just try again. And there, seems to have worked. Let's see. And yes, here is the flag. In the end, actually not a super hard challenge. What's really difficult here is the real world aspect, having to look through a lot of documentation and source code trying to identify the threat surface. But it's really good practice. By the way, when I started working on this video script, I also noticed that the latest API 6 was still vulnerable. That means, I guess, nobody reported it to them. Oops, I guess everybody thought like me, well, somebody else will report it for sure. So yeah, I decided to drop them an email. It was promptly fixed and it got assigned CVE-2022-24112. An attacker can abuse the batch request plugin to send requests to bypass the API restrictions of admin API. A default configuration of Apache API 6 with default API key is vulnerable to remote code execution. There's a check in the batch request plugin which overrides the client IP with its real remote IP, but due to a bug in the code, this check can be bypassed. Also, I didn't know who originally found it, so it was credited to the real world CTF. Thanks for watching and check out Patreon and stuff. Yeah, bye.